as we walk through this crazy life, God works through His Word, by His Spirit, in His people to transform us into the likeness of Christ. Therefore, Daily Intent is a streaming devotion of First Baptist Church of Cabool with the purpose of helping you walk intentionally with Christ day by day. As we prepare to go live, we ask that you would use the remaining time to pray that God would guide our words and open your hearts to obey Him today. If we can help you in your walk, or if you have any questions, please send us a message and we will get back with you as soon as possible. We pray that this is a blessing for you today. Welcome to First Baptist Church of Cabool. I'm Pastor Benjamin, and this is another episode of Daily Intent. I want to begin by saying welcome back, dailies. And for those of you that this is your first time, I would encourage you to hit that like button, subscribe to the channel, and join us as we continue to intentionally walk with Christ day by day. Today, we're going to continue to answer the question, what does the Bible say about social distancing? And as we seek to find an answer, it seems like everyone is looking for something or someone to blame for our current situation. Was it China? Was it the Democrats? Was it the Republicans? Was it the medical community? Was it a terrorist? Everyone is looking for an answer to what caused this social distancing. But the list, as it goes on and on, actually has had an explanation for a very long time. You see, social distancing existed long before it was ever a buzzword. Social distancing has existed almost since the beginning of the earth. Yesterday, we saw why social distancing feels so wrong. It's because God designed us to be socially involved with Him, with each other, and the world around us. We were designed to be relational creatures that use our unique gifts and abilities to serve God by loving others and caring for the world that He has given us. And so when we are denied that opportunity, it feels awkward. It feels weird. It feels like something is missing. It makes us feel like we are less than humans. So the question is, then why aren't we engaged? Why are we in this world? Why is this world around us so distant? And the answer is actually in Genesis chapter 3. Genesis chapter 3. And so if you have your Bible, you can follow along with me as we kind of look at Genesis 3 in an overview way, looking to understand what it might tell us about social distancing and when it began. And so we're going to begin in verse 1 of chapter 3 in your Bibles. And as we begin here, we see this creature enter the creation story, this serpent, and he enters in and he begins having a conversation with Eve, the woman that was created. And he begins questioning this woman and causing her to doubt. And ultimately, he lies to her and denies that she was created in the image of God. You see, Satan and this crafty serpent was denying what we just learned yesterday. Satan, from the beginning of time, has wanted to deny that we were created like God, that we were already like God in the way we are gifted and in the way we relate to Him and to others and to the world around us. You see, the people in Adam and Eve in this time, they were already like God in the fact that they were relating to God in a community, and they were relating to one another in a community, and they were overseeing the world that God had placed them over. They were His under shepherds. They were His stewards of the world. They already had everything they were longing for. They already had perfect food. But you see, Eve began to think that she was missing out on something. She began to selfishly desire to put herself over God instead of like God. See, she wasn't satisfied with being like God, being under God, as obedient to Him and her relation to Him. She was not satisfied in being like God in the sense that she was relating to another human. She was not satisfied in being like God in the sense that she was over creation. She wanted to be over God. She wanted more. And so we see in the very beginning, as she takes and eats of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, that she saw that the tree was good for food, that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise or to give her insight. So she took of its fruit and ate, and she also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves loincloths. And so we see here the entrance of sin into the world as Adam and Eve disobey the command of God. So they rebel against the design of God and how they relate to Him. You see, right there we see the entrance of social distancing, because they rebel against the created order of the way things were made. And so they are immediately separated from God, because we notice here that they are ashamed and they hide themselves. Their sin separates them from God, because at one time, we see earlier in chapter 2 that Adam and Eve would walk with God daily in the garden. He was in the presence of God. He was in relationship to God without shame, without fear, and they were in relation to each other without shame or fear. They did not know that they were naked and ashamed until after they sinned and rebelled against God. You see, our separation from others begins with our separation from God, from ignoring the rule that He has over our lives and the demand that He has over our lives as our Creator. And so this guilt and shame drove them to hide. And once they realize what had happened and God comes and He confronts them, we see that in this moment that God confronts them for why they did this. And so there is this immediate struggle here with what's going on. And then in verse 22 and following in 24, we see that the Lord, He puts them out of the garden where they were in the presence of God, the garden where they were in God's place, under God's rule and blessing, the place where they were in perfect communion with God and with each other. They are kicked out of that to work the land. And so they are immediately separated from God in that moment. Not only are they separated from God, they're separated from each other. And verse 16, it says, "So the woman," He said, "I will surely multiply your pain and childbearing, and pain you shall bring forth children. Your desire shall be for your husband, and he shall rule over you." There is an immediate conflict between husband and wife, in which one will be over the other, and there will be division within the family. But we see that carried out not just in husband and wife, but even later on in Genesis chapter 6, Cain and Abel, the children of Adam and Eve. Cain becomes jealous of Abel and his sacrifice, and he murders him because there is sin in his heart. You see, sin was crouching, God tells him. It was preparing to do these things. Sin separates us from God, and it separates us from each other in a relational, communal way. We are no longer in this relationship of good graces. Now we are being disciplined for our sin. We are under the curse of sin. Not only that, we see that we are separated from the world around us. Eve will fulfill her command to God of bearing children, but now it will be in pain. Adam will fulfill his command to work the earth, but now it will be against thorn and thistle. We can see this even in this text. He says, "You shall not eat of it. Cursed is the ground because of you. In pain you shall eat of it all the days of your life. Thorns and thistles it shall bring forth for you, and you shall eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your face you shall eat bread till you return to the ground, for out of it you were taken, for you are dust, and to dust you shall return." And so we see social distancing taking place in Genesis chapter 3 and following as God, as a curse from sin. Sin's curse on us is that we are distant from God, that we are distanced from each other, that our relationships are plagued by sin and and the shame that comes from that, and that we are separated from the world. We now toil against the pain of the world that we have. So even as we look to COVID-19 and we look for someone to blame, we need to understand that COVID-19 is a product of the sin of Adam and Eve. For this disease and famine and a world is corrupted by sin. Sin and disease did not exist prior to sin. But disease is a effect of sin in this world. And so we see sin as the cause for social distancing. This is important for us to understand as we think about how we are to deal with or understand social distancing. And so I want us to learn a few lessons from this. Let's first look at this idea of being distorted in relationship to God. You see, man was created to worship and obey God. And it is inescapable that man will relate to God in a particular way, except for now man in his sinfulness, instead of worshiping the true God, will worship and serve idols that he thinks will give him what he wants. In other words, he's looking to these idols to serve him in a particular way. And so he'll serve them if they serve him. And so it's distorted. Our view of God and the world around us is distorted by our desire for things. And so we will place things on the throne of our heart and we will worship them when instead we should be worshiping God. Even in Romans chapter 1, it says what could be known about God is plain to them, but they've denied it. Instead of worshiping the Creator, they worship creation. And so we see this even in Scripture as it describes the world and the pains that we have. And so because of this social distancing, because of this sin that leads to a distancing from God, we will worship and seek out other gods, which will continually let us down. Not only that, we will have a distorted relationship with others. Instead of using our gifts, instead of using our talents in the way God created us for fellowship to help other people, to love other people, to be companions to other people. Instead of that, as fallen men and women, we will use our gifts to manipulate others as a tool for selfish purposes. We will see other people as a means to an end rather than an opportunity to obey God. So, as we look at our own relationships, what are ways that we are looking to other things to fulfill what only God can fulfill? Maybe we're looking to that new house or that new car or that job. And you know what? Maybe we were looking to a job before all of this began, and now that job's been ripped out from underneath us. Maybe we were looking at our identity in a particular job, our place as head of that job, and now that we don't have that opportunity anymore, we have no identity anymore because we made that our God. Maybe we were looking to our relationships to fulfill a longing in us, to fulfill our own selfish purposes, rather than seeing them as an opportunity to glorify God. And so we distorted those relationships, and now they're frustrated because we don't have what we had before, and it's revealing to us that where we put our hopes and in things that could not satisfy. So what areas of your life are you using your children as an opportunity to serve you rather than an opportunity to glorify God, or your spouse, or your job, or your coworkers, or whatever it may be? Not only that, we have a distorted relationship to the world. Instead of ruling the world in obedience out of good stewards, we see it as an opportunity to serve our own selfish purposes. We see it as an opportunity to serve ourselves. One author says it this way: in fact, the very greatness of man's sin consists in the fact that he is still an image-bearing God. What makes sin so heinous or hideous is that man is prostituting such a splendid gift. It's disturbing, really, that we're using the gifts that God gave us, but because of sin and the distance it created in us, towards God and others and towards the world around us. We're using it sinfully. I want to end with one last quote. After man's fall into sin, the image of God was not annihilated. The image that we were created in, it was not done away with, but it was perverted. The image in its structural sense, in the way that we're able to think and intellectually and have a conscience, those things, they're still there. Man's gifts, endowments, and capacities were not destroyed by the fall, but now man began to use these gifts in ways that are contrary to God's will. What changed, in other words, was not the structure of man, but the way in which he functioned, the direction in which he was going. So let me ask you this. What is the direction of your life? Are you looking to God or something else that you've made as a, quote, God, something else you're looking to as the divine reason for existence? Are you looking to those things in ways that they cannot serve? Are you looking to others to serve voids that you have? I would ask that you would use this time to evaluate your life, that you might think about this distance that you're experiencing as an opportunity to evaluate that void in your own life that sin has caused. If you would, pray with me. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day that you've given us. We thank you for the opportunity to serve you. We thank you for the blessing of your word to confront our hearts. And we pray that you would help us to find a way out. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Hope that you have a blessed day. This is the hour, the darkest place. Dante's Inferno, the devil's maze. It's a good world.